Hello, welcome to the garage. Today I received a new boards from JLC PCB and I'll be working on turning this into that. Now I'm actually lying to you. I've been working on this board for a whole week and been filming bits and pieces bit by bit. So today I will show you what I've done and how did I get the board working with the Toyota Prius inverter. Surprise, surprise, I found that my board is bigger. So what could I do? I used the Toyota board as a template and marked the holes on my board. However, I've decided I will only make two holes on one side and I'll leave one side hanging. I've received five boards from JLC PCB and two of them were populated and three of them were blank. As I was saving money, I've decided to populate two boards. So I used one of the blank boards as a template and marked the holes using the Toyota board as a guidance. And I marked again and again and marked again. So now once I got it right, I used one of the blank boards to drill the holes in it first and then use it as a template to drill the holes in the board that was assembled. You could see I'm trying the blank board. I see my pilot holes line up very well, so I could now drill the main board. And now main board drilled, I found another problem. The edge of the board is extended a little bit too far, so it was resting on the edge of a mounting bracket of the inverter. I decided I'd trim a couple of corners adjacent to the this mounting hole. Cutting corners, I thought that was not in my character, but I suppose one would have to start someday. First, I will solder a JST connect, as it is the more complex one to solder, as well as it has a low profile, so it will less likely to interfere with other parts or connectors. I placed flux on the connector's track pads, so it actually was quite handy because it was held in place by the flux and you can easily position connector correctly. And I use a drag soldering technique to solder through the connector and actually worked really well. You could see that there's no bridges whatsoever and the solder went really well and it looks very clean. And the last step, I used a flux cleaner just to clean a connector and area around the connector thoroughly. All I needed in the end is to solder ADC connector so I can apply power and a 3-pin programming connector for the STM32 chip. Okay, so now we connected the 12 volts and we have indication that power is working. We need to check the main supply voltages. So I'll start from 3.3 volts, so I'll pick up the ground from FTDI connector and I check 3.30, that's great. The next one is a 5 volts, so I'll pick up one of these capacitors, it's 5.00, that's perfect. And now we need to check minus 5, which would be here, minus 5.00, amazing. And 26 is 25.7, perfect. So we have all our power in place. Now we need to program the STM32 module. Okay, I now connected the ST-Link programmer. I got power on. So we got power 12 volts to pin 1 and ground to pin 6. So I'm gonna plug ST-Link. ST-Link is in there.
On this board, we have two processors. One is STM32 and another one is ATmega328P. So ATmega is used to control the charger, where STM32 is used to control the functions of inverter. I've decided to program STM32 first and just play with an inverter and then maybe at a later date to play with the charger. So because of this, I will only program STM32 for now. I started a ST-Link utility and connected a programmer by going target connect. Now I'm programming a bootloader first. So I went to open a bootloader hex file and selected program and verify to program the bootloader. Next, I will program the actual firmware. I chosen this time FOC .hex, which is basically programming a field-oriented control firmware. I have programmed another board where I used sine firmware. So in this case, you have to choose sine.hex. Once firmware has been programmed, you could see that second LED starts flashing rather quickly. That means the firmware has been successfully programmed. Now with the board programmed, all I needed to do is to solder connectors. So I pretty much use similar technique and just placed the connector on flux and soldered appropriate pins here. On this one I went a little bit overboard, and as you can see I put a solder bridge. So I had to use a wick to wick out some extra solder. It worked out quite well in the end, and I managed to clear off all the extra solder and managed to produce quite a good quality connector. And after that I went all around the board soldering other connectors. And now, by the magic of video editing, voila, we have the whole board ready. Thank you for watching. In the next video, I will be installing the board into Inverter and testing and producing, hopefully, the PWM signals to control IGBTs. So if you want to watch more of this madness, please subscribe. If by any weird, strange circumstances you liked it, please smash that like button, as they say in America. Adios. Bye-bye.